And I didn't even leave myself a note. I just remembered. It's amazing.
You had been reminded.
Had I?
Well, yeah, not but
oh, yes, I have had several reminders, yes. Yes,
people
that's
can't come, so said, yeah. Record it.
Evening all. It's absolutely gorgeous to see you all. Yeah, we have had loads of apologies for tonight, and we were big worship from, it was never that kind of meeting, but goodness me, loads of people, so lots of people are enjoying themselves away and not being here, so we'll think of them while we're sat here tonight. Yeah, that's all there, but it's lovely, lovely to see you all. So, as promised, in the email and the bulletin, something a little different tonight. We have no Tim and we have no Rob. They are two of the apologies. They're both away on their halls at the moment. So it's just little old me. So please be gentle with me. But we are doing something a bit different. So I have asked you if you will come prepared with paper and a pen. And if you could get hold of some raffle tickets, some cloakroom tickets. But don't worry if you haven't, it is not compulsory. Well done, those of you who are waving them at me. Well done for your preparation. So some raffle tickets if you've got them, but don't worry if you haven't. It doesn't exclude you at all. And some paper and a pen. Because tonight we're going to go on a journey. Rather cheesily, we could call it a big journey. And that's what we're going to do. Now, so the evening is based on the theory of the labyrinth, a kind of prayer journey, worship journey. It has always been subject to a little bit of controversy. People didn't like it because they thought that it was pagan. However, certainly the Methodist Church in the UK have completely sanctioned it and said that it's a really good idea, and have even produced some resources to help people put labyrinths together. So you can think of tonight as based on a labyrinth, so it's a kind of theoretical journey in your mind. You might want to picture it as a journey through, for example, a theme park or a visitor attraction, and you might think of it like, you might just think of it as a nice walk out in the lovely countryside. Whichever does your thing, that's absolutely fine. It comes with a minor apology to anybody who was at Easy Church about a year ago, because we did something very similar then. You may remember it. It's not exactly the same, but I think even if it is, then these journeys, there's no harm in going on them more than once. So I know there's maybe a handful of you that I can see that were probably at that service a year or so ago. So it comes with an apology, but then kind of not with an apology, because, like I say, it's always good to take ourselves on these spiritual journeys. The idea of the labyrinth was it's been a path that people would imagine that would be used for pilgrimage, for meditation, for prayer, and for a different kind of worship. The ancient symbol of the labyrinth, it is said, creates a sacred space and leads us out of our ego to that which is within us. There's a quote here from Caroline Adams, and she says, "You are on the path exactly where you're meant to be right now, and from here you can only go forward, shaping your life story into a magnificent tale of healing, of courage, of beauty, of dignity, and of love." So, let's go on a journey together. So, a lot of it will be shared on screen through the course of the evening, so you won't have to stare at my big fat face all night. So hopefully you'll be able to see this, and we can take our way through this journey. So as we said, we are going on a big journey. I'm now going to give you the visualization of the journey. So this is what it looks like, and you may see what I meant earlier when I said maybe imagine it as a visitor attraction or a theme park. You can say that we see the way that you're going to go round, and that's the journey we're going to take tonight. So it's in several stages, and just to kind of break it down a little, we are talking about entering into the realm of the journey and making our outward journey. There's then what I'm calling an encounter zone in the middle, and all will be revealed when we get there. And then we make our way back, and we make our way back out again. So that's what we're going to be doing. We're going to enter, we're going to prepare for our encounter experience. We're going to have that encounter experience, and then we're going to make our way out and come back into the world. So the first spot in the journey is the entrance, and you can see it highlighted there. Here we will take off our coat and anything else that we've brought with us that we don't need in the journey. And here we're going to think about laying down some of the things that we carry that are maybe a little more spiritual and a little more emotional. You're going to hear a song. It's by one of my favourite artists, which is Martin Joseph. And I've done you all the favour of me not singing it and listening to him sing it tonight. And it's one of the most powerful songs that I've ever heard. And it's called The Things That We Have Carried Here. And it talks all about those burdens that we carry. Now, I have experienced some church services that I entered and were filled with all kinds of promise, and they may as well have been accompanied with a magic wand. They were going to take all my troubles away. And I had the service and I walked away and I still had my troubles. So this is slightly different. I'm not going to make any promises that tonight's journey is going to take any of your problems away. However, what I want you to do in the entrance here is think about at least setting them aside for a little while we go and have the journey. So we're going to relieve ourselves of those burdens. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to hand our things in at the cloakroom. Here's where the tickets come in, if you've got them. We'd like you to rip off one ticket for everything that you're going to hand into the cloakroom, that you're going to offload, that you're going to set down. And what I'd like you to visualize is that Jesus is standing behind the counter of the cloakroom. He is your cloakroom attendant for the evening. And he's going to accept all of your tickets. Now, if you've got raffle tickets, you can use them and write on them and physically hand them over. If you haven't, take your blank piece of paper and create yourself some numbers. Random numbers will do. Create yourself some little tickets. Just draw them on your pad. And we'd like you to visualize one ticket for everything you're going to just set down for a while with Jesus. Now, that could be at a very generic level. It could be things like guilt or shame or worry or fear. You may want to set down those burdens if you feel you're carrying them. It could be something way more specific. It could be a person who's really troubling you, and you're going to lay down all those worries. Just leave them at the door, and the safe thing is that you can have them back at the end of the night. You're if frozen. You want.
I don't know if you're still frozen.
I've frozen. Can everyone still hear me? Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Thanks. So whatever you lay down here is still going to be with Jesus at the end of the night. And if you want them back, you can have them. There's no fear. Because sometimes, I mean, laying these things down, if only it were that easy. But we may feel we may need to keep them with us as we leave, and that's fine. There's no problem. We'll come to that a little bit later. It may be a situation that's really troubling you, that you are carrying the weight of. So as the song plays, make a ticket out for each of the things that you are going to set down at the cloakroom and leave in Jesus' care for the entirety of the evening. Jesus is standing and he says to us, "Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." In the song from Martin Joseph, you will hear a line that says, "Freedom needs a volunteer to be beautiful." So just for this evening, however uncomfortable it may feel, would we go on a personal journey where we are prepared, just even briefly, to consider ourselves to be that volunteer to be beautiful. So here we go.
Coming down, it's beautiful. Let me raise you up now, my love, beautiful. 10,000 years of longing, and your story still untold. Wisdom is the knowing when to fall. Things that we have carried here, one day they will disappear, just like skin and bone, or death and stone. Things that we have carried here, freedom needs a volunteer to be beautiful. We can be beautiful. Seldom see the fallen sky, but we dig in the rubble deep to find survivors. If love ever kissed you, if your face ever cried, maybe then my hope is justified. Things that we have carried here, one day they will disappear, just like skin and bone, or death and stone. The things that we have carried here, freedom needs a volunteer to be beautiful. We can be beautiful. Like skin and bone, or death and stone, yeah. Things that we have carried here, freedom needs a volunteer to be beautiful. Beautiful, you are, you know, You're so beautiful, you got no idea. You're beautiful, you are, you know. You're beautiful. Beautiful. You're so
the next section of our journey goes from the entrance towards the encounter zone. And as you can see, it's kind of a winding path, and you could very much imagine it as a walk through the woods. And that's exactly what we're going to do. I'm going to show you a video of a gentle walk through the woods. And the idea is that we are preparing ourselves. So we're walking away from those things that I'm sure many of us found really tough to think about and leave behind and brave to hand over to Jesus. But we want to leave them behind just for the journey. So maybe the first part of the journey, you may just be clearing that out and make doing your best to leave it behind you. And we can then begin, as this walk goes on, as we're clearing our head, thinking about the love that Jesus has for us. I'll share some words in the early part of the journey, and then I'll just leave the video to run. We are safe here. And as we look around and see the beauty in this little wonder, let's turn our minds to the depth of love that Jesus has for all of us. Paul expressed it like this. He said, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus." Thank you. So we're prepared, and our heads are clear, and we come into the centre of tonight's journey, the first of two encounters with God. The first of those zones, we want to kind of ask the question, what is God like? But develop it a little bit further with our own thoughts. So, the way this is going to work, one of my favourite authors, doesn't that make me sound well read? Don't be fooled, is a woman called Rachel Held Evans, who sadly is no longer with us. She died, I think it was last year. It may even have been slightly before then. But a wonderful author and thinker, and just loved her thoughts on God and spirituality and the church and all of that. And she wrote a book before she died, which is essentially a children's book, and it's called What Is God's Like? What Is God Like? Sorry. Now, for me, the book follows the principle of the Toy Story movie, which is, yes, it might well be for kids, but there's plenty in there for adults too. So I think the story works on both levels. So what's going to happen? You're going to see the pages of the book before you. And I hired a very expensive narrator this afternoon to narrate the story for me. She let me have it for cheap. And so listen to the story as it's read. And what we'd like you to do is, if any of these thoughts trigger anything with you about what your God is like for you, then let those thoughts run. Let those thoughts happen. This is all about you and God, nobody else, and there's nothing of this that needs to be shared. So you can go into this encounter zone and be totally honest about how you see God and where you see God in the world and what God means to you. This couldn't be more personal. So as the story unfolds, let your thoughts unfold too, and let's go into encounter zone one and meet God.
Is God like? That's a very big question. One that people from places all around the world have wondered about since the beginning of time. And while nobody has seen all of God, because God is far too big for any of us to fully see, we can know what God is like. God is like an eagle, sharp-eyed and swift, with wings so wide you can play under their shadows. God is like a river, constant and life-giving. When you grow near God, you'll sprout up as strong as a tree. God is like the stars, forever present and bright. Even when they feel far away, you can always look up and see them winking at you. God is like a shepherd, brave and good, a protector who loves her sheep so much that she watches over all of them and knows each of their names by heart. God is like a fort, strong and secure, with walls that are mighty and safe. Inside there are hidden places to hold you when you're scared or need a quiet place to rest. God is like a gardener, patient and nurturing. God plants, waters, weeds, and fertilizes the earth until every good thing on it seeks the nourishing sun and grows. God is like the flame of a candle, warm and inviting. With God close by, you can look at the light and see through the darkest of nights. God is like the wind, passionate and full of mystery. God is both here and mysteriously also over there. God is everywhere, swirling through the world, whistling across mountain ranges, rustling through trees, and pressing against your cheeks on a breezy day. God is like an artist, creative and unpredictable, always busy making and remaking everything brilliant and new. God is like a mother, strong and safe. You can crawl up into her lap whenever you want to and she will hold you until you fall asleep. God is like a father, gentle and safe. He will pull you on top of his shoulders to give you a bird's eye view of all creation. God is like three dancers, graceful and precise. They move to the same music in very different ways, showcasing all of God's elegance and rhythm in your life. God is like a rainbow, vivid and full of colour, a dazzling reminder of promise and hope for all people after a storm. God is like a best friend, faithful and true, closer to you than even your brothers or sisters. And because we know what God is like, we know that God is kind, God is forgiving, God is slow to get angry, God is quick to be glad. God is happy when you tell the truth and sad when things are unfair. She is your protector. He is trustworthy. They are friends when you are when you feel alone. God hopes. God perseveres. What is God like? That's a very big question. One that people from all places, all around the world, throughout all time, have answered in many different ways. Keep searching. Keep wondering, keep learning about God. But whenever you aren't sure what God is like, think about what makes you feel safe, what makes you feel brave, and what makes you feel loved. That's what God is like.
We move into the second section of the encounter zone. And this I'm calling connected. We've talked for some years now in big worship circles, in Easy Church, in amongst all of us, about the power of connection, about the power of those relationships we have with each other and what they mean to us. And so that's what I'd like you to focus on during this little section. I am going to subject you to listening to me sing this time, so I'm going to sing a song, and while it plays, you've got a job to do. I'm going to stop the share so that you will be able to see more of the screens. And I'd like you to just look at all of the people that are here tonight. And if you're on a tablet and you only get four screens, just try and, if you can, page through so you get to see more of the people that are here. And use your paper that you've brought along and your pen to develop a to-do list for, let's say, the next month. So, for example, if you look around the screens and do you see someone who maybe looks a bit sad or stressed? If so, contact them. Do you see people who have had a positive impact on you? Then tell them. Do the people you see remind you of some other people that you could do to contact? Maybe someone who would normally be here tonight, or somebody completely different. Let your mind wander and contact them. Do you see people who make you feel good? Thank them. Connect with them. Do you see people who you're in regular touch with? Keep it up. Do you see people who inspire you? Tell them. Do you see people who you worry about? Reach out to them. Now, don't limit this exercise to the questions I've asked. You could ask, let your mind go wherever it goes. And don't feel like you have to complete your to-do list before you go to bed tonight. So let's take some time, look at the people that we're here with tonight, feel that connection, feel the certain knowledge that God is right in the middle of us all, because that's what connection is all about. This is God brought to life in this second encounter zone. So here we go. A name, what would it be, and would you tell it to his face if you were faced with him in all his glory? What would you ask if you had just one question? Yeah, God is great. Yeah, God is good. Yeah. What if God was one of us? Just a slob like one of us. Just a stranger on a bus. Try to make his way home. If God had a face, what would it look like? Would you want to see it there? If seeing meant that you would have to believe in things like heaven and in Jesus, the saints, and all of the prophets. Yeah, God is great. Yeah, God is good. Yeah. What if God was one of us? Just a slob like one of us. Just a stranger on a bus. Try to make his way home. With no one calling on the phone. Except for the Pope, maybe in Rome. Yeah. What if God was one of us? Just a slob like one of us. Just a stranger on a bus. Try to make his way home. Back up to heaven all alone. Like some holy rolling stone. With no one calling on the phone. Except for the Pope, maybe in Rome. So hopefully you have a to-do list, an action list for the next month. Take your time. We're now going to start to make our way back to the beginning. This return journey is where we want to focus on our place in the world. You could call it an intercessory journey. We're thinking about where we sit in the world, what the things are that we do, choose to do, all that kind of stuff. There's a song that you're going to hear, which is an incredible version of the Coldplay song Fix You, which we heard while we were watching The Handmaid's Tale a couple of weeks ago. It was really incredible. And rather poignantly, it's by a band called Fearless Soul. So here we go, on our way, as you can see there, from the encounter zone back to the exit. So here we go.
When you try your best but you don't succeed, when you get what you want but know what you need, when you feel so tired but you can't sleep, stuck in reverse, and the tears come streaming down your face, when you lose something you can't replace, when you love someone but it goes to waste, could it be worse? Light will guide
We're coming now to the final stage of tonight's journey. So we're kind of back where we started. We've come to the exit and the gift shop, of course. No attraction would be complete without one. So there's a couple of things to do here. First of all, you all need to have a very individual conversation with Jesus about the tickets you handed him earlier. And he sees it very simply. If you want, he'll keep them all. If you want, he'll destroy them all. If you need any of them back, you can take them. He's happy for anywhere in between. And he wants us to know that at any stage, at any time, we can pass some tickets over to him if we need some respite. And we can do that through our knowledge of God, and we can do that through the connections that we make around us. He will always be there. There's no time limit on this conversation. He can see everybody at once. So I'm going to play a piece of music, just an instrumental piece of music, and during that time you can have that interaction with Jesus. You can have that conversation. Talk to him. See what he says. The other thing is that you can visit the gift shop, because here we have free gifts and you're allowed any one of these or all nine. You can grab a ticket, write it on and put it in your wallet, in your pocket. You can restock with all of these amazing gifts. They're available to us all the time. Sometimes we kind of forget about them. So grab a gift or nine. They're all available in the gift shop. So as you hear the piece of music, just to close, well, not quite to close, but to finish the journey, those are the things that we'd like you to think about: picking up your gifts and having that conversation with Jesus about the tickets that you left behind earlier. Our journey's almost over. I want to just say thank you, first of all, for coming on it and throwing yourself into it and doing whatever you need to do. Now, I'm also conscious that it's been a very personal journey in a way, in that it's been about us all as individuals and our relationship with God. And then obviously that section in the middle where we're thinking about our relationships with each other. But we very much want to go out together. in many ways, the hymn, the song that we sing regularly, which is We Are People on a Journey, would have been perfect. But we've sung it so much lately, I wanted to do something different. So we are going to sing together as we leave the journey zone tonight. So thank you all, and we'll sing on the way out. Now, this is a song that you probably will know quite well. But I didn't want the sort of traditional version of it. So I threw Jane the challenge, and she's come up with something rather beautiful. So we're going to sing together on the way out. So if you can keep yourself muted, here we go. Thanks for that, Jane, and thank you everyone for coming on the journey this evening. I've just stuck the grace in the chat, so if we could unmute and share the grace together to close. So thank you all so much for tonight. May the grace
of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, forevermore. Forever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you.
Good night.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you, Kevin.
Bye. Take care, bye, everyone.
See you soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Oh, sure.
Thank you for that, Kev. That was brilliant. Thank you.
I could have a word with you, Kevin.
No.
God, yeah, Kevin. Oh, well. Oh. When you've got a minute, Kevin.
Go on, Mabel. Yeah.
Well, I only know that I've got to the stage at my age, and God is my life, and what I do pray is that He won't ever leave me. So wonderful. that's what I pray.
Well, thank you for that.
I would hate that, but I'm sharing it now. I didn't intend to, but...
Well, Mabel, thank you. And I'll tell you what, lass, you've got nothing to worry about.
I don't.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.